All right, thank you for joining me on this episode of The Gospel Truth. I'm your host, Marlon Wilson, and we have a great show today. I have Dr. George Yancey with me, and we're going to be discussing discrimination, Christian discrimination in academia. And this is a study that I've really never heard of. And I watched Dr. George Yancey on Bible Beer Consortium. I always jack up that pronunciation. I don't know why. But I watched him on there, and I found his studies to be very interesting because it was something I've never really heard of or really thought anybody was doing a study on. So, but Dr. George Yancey is doing a study on that, or he has done a study on it. He continues to grow in that study as well. But before we bring him in, I do want to go over a couple of announcements I have coming up. November 23rd, I have a debate coming up between Will Duffy and CJ Barnes, and they're debating, is open theism biblical? I have November 27th, I have at 6 p.m., Daniel Cahey versus Anthony Silverstroke, and they're debating young earth creation and morality in the Bible. November 29th, I have at 6 p.m., I have David Powelman versus David Lewis, and they're debating, is Calvinism true? And November 30th at 5 p.m., I have Zach Turbis versus Craig Joyner, and they'll be debating, does Calvinism teach the biblical understanding of the gospel? So I have a whole bunch of shows coming up. And if you want to update all these shows, of all the shows I do have coming up, these are just the next four shows. If you want to update on all the other shows that are coming up, you can go ahead and go to my YouTube page, subscribe there, and check out all the videos, all the updated debates and interviews that I have coming up in the future. Also, speaking of subscribing, can you take time to go ahead and go to Facebook as well and like and follow there? And also, all my content is on podcasts for the person that's on the go or people that just like to listen to podcasts as they do their thing. All my content is on every podcast platform, Google Play, iTunes, and so forth. So go ahead and check that out. Go ahead and subscribe there and put the content out there. Over here at The Gospel Truth, we're about engaging the culture with Christian truth. And what that entails is debates, interviews, and biblical lessons. So, you know, the whole goal is to get the content out there as far as so we can reach the masses with this stuff in order to draw people and open people's hearts to Christ, right? So if I'm not doing it for Christ, I'm doing it for no reason. So I want you guys to be able to take this content, use it, get it out there. Hopefully you're learning something from the debates and the interviews and things like that in order to glorify Christ in this, and using this platform to glorify him. But with that said, I do want to bring in my guest, Dr. George Yancey. But before I do, I want to introduce him. Dr. George Yancey is a professor of sociology at Baylor University. He has published several research articles on the topics of institutional racial diversity, racial identity, academic bias, progressive Christians and anti-Christian hostility. His books include Compromising Scholarship, a book that explores religious and political biases in academia, What Motivates Cultural Progressiveness, a book that examines activists who oppose the Christian right, There Is No God, a book that investigates atheism in the United States, and So Many Christians, So Few Lions, a book that assesses Christianophobia in the United States. He has a Bachelor of Science Economics from West Texas University, State University, a Master of Arts Economics, University of Texas of Austin, and a PhD in Sociology, University of Texas at Austin. So let me bring my guest in real quick. How's it going, doctor?
Pretty good. How are you doing?
All right. Thank you for joining me. I appreciate you.
Thanks for having me.
All right. So let's roll right into this, man. So give me a rundown real quick of what ministries you have going on right now.
Well, you know, it's kind of interesting because my wife and I, we just joined our church like about a year and a half ago, and I have three boys under five.
Wow.
So right now we're kind of laying low on doing ministries, with our church and that stuff. I do help out for like the Thanksgiving feast and we're involved with a home group there. And I'm starting to talk to the youth minister and the college minister about getting involved. So I do want to get involved in a ministry, but right now, with our boys being where they're at, you know, that's probably my ministry at this point. But it won't be for long. I imagine it won't be just my only ministry for long.
Yeah, I hear you, man. I do understand the struggle with a bunch of little ones.
Yeah,
I have a 21-year-old And but she's not in the house.
Too young right for now. That, man.
The ones I have in the house right now is 5, 2, about to be 3.
Oh, and then wait.
A 1 year old.
21 and 5?
21, 5, 3, and 2.
Wow.
Yeah, oh, 1, I mean, my bad, 1. My son just turned 1. So, Wow. Yes, it is a huge, you talk about a huge gap. Yeah. And I got these 3 little munions in the house, you know, these little little people in the house. So I do understand the struggle. And, you know, I pray that God will, you know, open the avenues for you. You know what I mean? So you'll be able to dive headfirst into a ministry. And when you do dive headfirst into it, that you'll glorify God in it, man. So I'm praying for that, praying for you and your family for that.
Yeah, I'm planning on diving back into doing ministry probably in the next year or two. But right. I got to get my youngest a little bit more self-sufficient before I can really do that.
For sure. I totally get it. So when I saw your studies on Christianophobia, and like I said, I first heard of your studies when I was watching the Bible Beer Consortium, your guest speaking event that you had there. And I was wondering what exactly drew you to that? Like what exactly drew you to that particular area of study? Out of all the studies you could have studied, that particular area sort of drew you in. How'd you get there?
Well, I kind of got there because first thing I wanted to study was academic bias. My interest was, you know, was there academic bias? And that, I got interested in that because I saw research claiming that there wasn't, but I thought the research was poorly done. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to do the research right. And when I documented academic bias, you know, it led me, because, you know, my finding was that the groups I looked at that faced the most bias was conservative Christians. And so that got me more interested in trying to see, you know, is this sort of so this just unique to academia, or is this something that's in our society in general to a certain extent? And so that's what got me interested in wanting to study what I call Christianophobia and the like. So, you know, and yeah, I am a Christian, and so, you know, it matters, but I like to think that I would be interested in it even if I wasn't a Christian, just like, you know, I'm interested in Islamophobia. I'm interested in anti-Semitism. I don't do a lot of research there because a lot of other people are doing research in those areas. But, you know, I care about those issues as well.
Yeah. Because, you know, you always hear it, you know, you always hear about this idea of, you know, in the universities, you know, how they're progressively growing more and more secular, you know, as the days go by, more liberal in their stance, you know, as you watch the news, you're always hearing that. So I've always wondered, like, is there anybody out there studying this area? You know, is there Christians in the academic field studying this particular area? And if there is any Christians that are studying this particular area, what are they coming up against? You know, what buffers are they coming up against? And the fact that you're doing it, and you're essentially doing it in a college that's not necessarily the most conservative platform either. So I was like, man, how is he doing this? It's such a university as this, you know, Baylor. I at least from what I understand is not necessarily the conservative on a more conservative aspect. So it's very interesting.
Yeah, obviously it's not as conservative as, say, a Liberty or something like that. Yeah. But, you know, when I did most of my work, in fact, I've just started at Baylor. I did most of my work on a state campus, University of Texas. Yeah. Okay. I was only now started at Baylor.
Yeah, that's right.
So Baylor is at least a Christian school. And so, you know, there's more openness to this. But, okay, you know, part of it is that because of what my findings on academic bias, one would expect that you're going to get less support in academia to study something like this. It just makes sense. And of course, it's hard to get grants studying something like this. It's harder, you know, to get published studying something like this. And if I didn't have my previous publishing career ahead of time, I probably wouldn't have tackled this because I wouldn't have had the confidence to know what was good work and what was not good work. Okay. You know, so there's that. But also a part of it is that Christians, you know, don't always support this type of stuff. I mean, we put our money towards, and I don't want to sound too negative, but some, you know, we put our money towards politics. We put plenty more money towards buildings or stuff like that, which I'm not saying that we shouldn't do that at all, but I'm just saying that we also need to engage the culture with Christian academics, with Christian entertainers, with Christian artists, you know, these sort of things, that's important too. And so, you know, it's a double barrel problem that we have to look at. And I think Christians have to take some responsibility for the fact that there's not more Christian academics because we've sort of have fled away from academia.
Yeah, that's interesting. So from looking at your studies, I noticed that, and you pointed it out in your PowerPoint presentation when you were doing your when you had the invite guest speaker at the BBC, you pointed out that the fundamentalists are the fundamentalists encounter more hostility than that of Republicans.
Yes.
Or politically conservative.
Yes.
Can you go into that a little bit? Can you dive into that a little bit? And how you came to that conclusion?
Yeah, and let me first just state that was an unexpected conclusion for me, which gives me more confidence that's probably true. Because I thought that political issues would matter more than religious issues to academics. I was thinking that, let me try to get a better position. I was thinking that, you know, that academics would care more about your politics than what you believe religiously. And so I suspect there may have been some anti-religious bias, but I thought that the anti-conservative bias would be more. Mm-hmm. But when I ran my research, it was the other way around. And so, and since then, I've done some, you know, a little bit of qualitative work to sort of figure out why this may be the case. And so I just have a couple of, you know, reasons why I think it may be the case. I think one of the reasons may be that you may be a Republican, but you may be a moderate Republican and have beliefs that at least somewhat conform to what people want in academics. I think when people think about conservative Protestants, they're thinking about certain religious beliefs, that's harder to do that. Because, and this is just a sense that I get, that issues of abortion and sexuality are more emotional type of triggers, for lack of a better term, for some academics than other types of issues. And so you may be a Republican who's a pro-choice Republican, for example, mm-hmm. or and very supportive of LGBT stuff. Mm-hmm. And so that doesn't make people as angry than if you went the other way around. If you're a Christian who, say, wants a big welfare state but also wants to stop abortion, I think that makes some people in academia even angrier. Mm-hmm. And then another thing that I think might be happening is that I think it really gets back to worldview. That do you believe that that humans are perfectible? And if you do, then that's hard to jive with a Christian attitude of worldview that humans are not perfectible apart from Christ. I think that politically you could get there as a conservative, thinking that humans are perfectible, you just have a different solution. And I suspect that's less threatening than someone who says, no, humans are not perfectible this side of heaven. We must adjust what we can do, but we must recognize that we're not perfectible. So I think in some ways, there's a worldview conflict that's stronger for Christians against academics than, say, for political conservatives against academics. And so that's a couple of reasons that I think that we see the hostility more so. But the fact of the matter is it is. I mean, the data shows that it is. Trying to figure out why it is, I think, is an interesting question that I think we still need some more answers to.
Do you think some of the quote-unquote phobia is just? Do you think some Christians sort of bring it upon themselves? Or do you think that just, you know, these individuals who have this phobia or don't really necessarily favor the fundamentalist position, do you think that it's just that, or you think it's the Christians sometimes bring it upon themselves?
Yeah. You know, as I answer this question, let me turn on the lights because I think the lighting on me is really bad. So let me turn on an overhead light. It might be a little bit better. Okay. Or it may not. We'll soon see. Okay, that's a little bit better. Yeah. All right. Here's how I would answer a question like that. There are some African-Americans who bring on themselves because they act like criminals, because they are criminals, you know, being treated as criminals. You know, I'm an African-American. I obviously do not condone racism. you know, I have no patience for. But I ain't gonna say, you know, hey, there ain't no blacks out there that you should avoid, because there are. I've heard them. I bet you have too.
Yeah.
So there's always people who how should I say fit the stereotype. And whatever stereotype you have, you're gonna find some people who are. And you may even find some systematic evidence that some people are more likely to. But the problem with stereotypes is that we get hooked into them, and then we are unable to distinguish between someone who is or someone who is not.
Yeah.
And then we paint with this broad brush. Yeah. So I'm not going to say there are not Christians who are very hateful or intolerant ignorant. A lot of these stereotypes that are out there. You know, we'd be fooled to say there aren't Christians who fit into that. The question is, do we use that stereotype then to judge, you know, these whole group? And do we discriminate against them occupationally or in other ways due to this stereotype? And that's where you stop saying, okay, there are some black people who act a fool. But, you know, that doesn't mean you get to treat black people in general for that way, because some people do.
Yeah. And, you know, And like you said, that's the concern, right? It's like this broad brushing, this broad brush painting of all this whole group. And it's that inability to advance in the career. It's that inability to put out an article that you hope to be approved or to be read by peers in your academic field. You know what I mean? To be able to do these things. And because you're a fundamentalist, you know, you're like, nope. Push it to the side, you know. I don't want nothing to do with it. So, yeah, that's interesting right there. And I thought that I was like, man, maybe some Christians bring it upon themselves. You know what I mean? Some of them act like bigots, if you will. You know what I mean?
Yep.
Act like knuckleheads. You know what I mean? Instead of, and like my show, the whole title of my show, you know, engaging the culture of Christian truth, being able to engage the culture in a manner that's becoming of Christ, that represents Christ. In a way that's not going to get you broad brushed. You know what I mean? That's not going to get you blackballed, if you will. You know what I mean? Though there are some who has that inherent bias, but it's a matter of carrying yourself to represent yourself. So if those biases do come, they're biases that are unwarranted. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They're phobias that are unwarranted, you know? So I thought that may have been the case. You know, some of them do cause it upon themselves. So what do you say is some of the major concerns, you know, as you do this study and you see the results of this study, what are some of the major concerns as you progress forward in your studies that you see the trajectory of these colleges in the direction that they're going, you know?
Well, you know, I think one of my major concerns, and I think I think a lot of the sort of discriminations and phobias and stuff like that have a lot of things in common. You know, they're not exact, obviously, but they have a lot of things in common. And one of the things I think that, you know, let me put it this way. All right, since I'm an African-American and a Christian, you know, and I've seen both sides, you know, what is it about being an African-American, you know, and racism compared to Christianophobia? You know, they have some things in common. Where they differ? And one of the ways they differ is that, you know, we talk about racism, we're talking about the potential of violence. You're talking about, being seen as a criminal, these sort of things, which is not there in Christianophobia. But what's Christianophobia have that racism doesn't have? And the people with Christianophobia tend to be powerful in ways that people who are racist. Not, I'm not talking about structural racism. I'm not talking about people who don't care. People who are racist don't tend to have the same sort of power that people with Christianophobia have. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, people who are racist, and I think the research kind of shows this, tend to be lower educated, you know, not wealthy. Doesn't mean that they can't still, you know, take a tire iron up your head, and right. Violence is still there, mm-hmm. and there's problems. And I'm not denying that there's also forms of institutional racism that's a problem. But people with Christianophobia tend to be educated, white, wealthy, male. They have power to do things, such as not allow a professor to get a job, such as, you know, control, certain media cultures and produce certain stories. They have the power to do things that most people with racism really don't have the power to do. And so in academia, you know, part of what disturbs me is that because of this power, because of the potential to do this sort of harm, it becomes problematic. And you know, there's also this sort of subtle issue that the people tend to have Christianophobia, I think even more so than people who are especially overtly racist. They tend to deny that they have bigotry. Whereas what I find is that people who, I mean, I, you know, if you look at some documentaries of people who are only racist, they're almost proud that they're bigots, you know, and that's disturbing in its own right. But in some ways, it's harder to convince someone with Christianophobia that they actually have a bigotry, even though they may act in those ways. And even when you point out that, you know, you're treating people differently based on religion, they have their rationale for why they treat people differently. Mm-hmm. I think that creates an additional problem, because it's like the alcoholic. If someone's an alcoholic and they are willing to admit they're an alcoholic, you have a shot of helping them. Mm-hmm. If they're an alcoholic and they say, no, I'm not an alcoholic, what are you talking about? Mm-hmm. There's no way you can help them. And most of us who've been alive a while know, even not alcoholism, that there's certain people with certain problems that will not try to get help for those problems. And we know that there's no way that they're going to be helped because they're not willing to get help for those problems. So I think that's going to be an additional burden in Christianophobia. When people who are in such denial that there is a problem, it's going to be hard in order to deal with the issue that's at stake.
Do you believe that they are, do you think they are aware of that they have a problem? Like, do you think they're like consciously aware that they have that issue, or is it something like they're in some sort of denial state?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that's
a great question. I wish I had a concrete answer. I would fall back on the studies we know about confirmation bias, on how we tend to look for information that confirms our own biases and ignore information that goes against that. Mm-hmm. You know, and we all suffer from that. And so my suspicion is that because of that, that they legitimately do not think that they have a bias, although some may do. And one of the things about people who are, and another thing about these, they tend to be progressive, politically progressive and irreligious. So when you look at that sort of subculture, their social identity is built on the fact that they are tolerant, they're inclusive, that they treat people fairly. And so if in some ways that makes it harder for them to recognize that they may not, whereas if you're going to say a pretty hierarchical subculture and say, hey, you guys are hierarchical, and they know they're hierarchical, they may say, yeah, we're hierarchical, so what about it? And then you have to convince them that's a problem. Whereas I suspect people with Christianophobia, they say, well, no, we don't have a problem. So, and then, you know, if you can convince them, and I know from interactions, a lot of times when you can convince them, yeah, you know, there is mistreatment, then they justify it, you know, just as the person in the hierarchical culture would justify it. Well, yeah, we're treating Christians differently because they're ignorant, or because of this, or because of that. But just to get to the point where they even acknowledge that it's an issue, I think it's going to be tough.
So are you able to present, or are there any cases that you know of where this bias or this Christianophobia has been seen and I guess legally went to the legal realm as far as like charges being brought against like a university or somebody actually filing a lawsuit for academic bias or something like that? Are there any situations like that? Any cases of that nature?
I would say that there's a couple of cases, legal cases, that I think are worth noting. First is the University of Iowa. I don't know if you know about this case, but there's this policy called an all-comers policy, which basically argues, are you familiar with the all-comers policies?
I'm not.
Okay. Basically, it's a policy some universities have that make it so that if you have a student group, you cannot discriminate in the leadership of the group by religion. So if you are a, you know, Christian intervarsity group, according to this all-comers policy, you cannot say that your leaders have to be Christian. Okay?
Okay.
Now, all right, so it's really if you, I don't know if you know much about disparate impact and this sort of things, it really is a great case for disparate impact because, you know, conservative Christians are most more likely than other organizations to say, well, we want our religious leaders to be of our faith. Mm-hmm. Well, University of Iowa, and University of Iowa is not the only one that's done this. Most famous case is Vanderbilt, and they're private, and so they probably will get away with it. But University of Iowa was a state university, mm-hmm. and so they were sued. And the first go around, they lost a lawsuit because the plaintiffs were able to show that University of Iowa was not enforcing this on Muslim organizations. Okay. The Muslim organizations were saying our leaders have to be Muslim, but they're forcing it on the Christian organization. So to me, it was a clear cut case of Christianophobia. So what University of Iowa did was they said, okay, we're going to force this on all religious groups that you cannot say who your religious leaders are. We really are going to do it this time. Well, they were sued again. And then they lost again. And the reason why, and I think this shows the weakness of the all-comers policy. The reason why they lost the second time and was really slapped down very hard was because the judge came back and said, look, you're only enforcing this on religious groups. We have a group, and I forget the exact name of the group, but it was an Asian group. And as part of their requirement for leaders, it must be respect for this Asian culture. I don't know whether it was, I forget whether it was a specific culture. I forget which one it is, Korean or Taiwanese or something like that. Mm-hmm. And so basically what that organization was doing was what Christian groups were doing, Muslim groups were doing, saying, we want you to be our leader. You have to believe what we want you to believe. And the court said, you cannot single out religious groups just to do that and not non-religious groups. And so to me, it showed just how far they were willing to go to sort of keep the Christian groups under their thumb until this point. It also shows that student organizations, their leaders should believe what the group is about. Mm-hmm. It's kind of ridiculous to have a pro-choice group headed by a pro-lifer, you know?
Right.
You know, I mean, to have someone who does not like women to head up a women's group.
Yeah.
You know, these things just don't make sense, but they're being forced on by Christians. And other colleges have done this, by the way. Mm. So that's one case I think is very, very noteworthy. Second case you probably have heard of is the Masterpiece Cake Shop case. Yes. They went to the Supreme Court. And the reason why it was struck down, which is really noteworthy, I think really sets a stage and was a decision that, you know, not exactly the decision I would want, but just almost as good. The reason why I struck down was the Civil Rights Commission. I forget whether they're called coordinators or ministers or what have you. You know, they put on the record a lot of vile anti-Christian stuff. Mm. And so the court said, you know, you can't do that. You cannot make these decisions, you know, based on your own anti-Christian. They didn't say bigotry, but I would say bigotry. And I think that's noteworthy because what the Supreme Court basically stated, and I think people didn't always get this, basically stated that anti-Christian bigotry is a problem. Mm. You know, that's in a Supreme Court case, and so I'm not a lawyer, but it seems to me that you can now, as a lawyer, if you can find evidence of anti-Christian bigotry in a decision, you can rely on that case. I mean, a lot of people are looking at as far as, you know, LGBT issues and stuff. And I grant that that's an issue there. But what the real issue is that the Supreme Court has said anti-Christian bigotry is a problem. And you cannot do that when you're making decisions that are going to affect Christians. And I think that's huge when you think about that. So those are two, I think, very important court cases, which I think sort of show that, you know, to some degree, there is some recognition of it. That I'm not naive to think that all court cases are going to go that way. But those, I think, were two important ones.
Interesting. Do you see any correlation, or have you found in your studies any correlation between being Black and Christian, where that's almost like a double whammy? If you will, yeah. Have you seen any study in your studies, any correlation of that degree, where if you're Black and Christian, like, oh man, it's over, or is it still separation?
Yeah, I've not seen that yet. I can see how that might be, but it also might not be, because the same people who tend to hate Christians don't tend to hate Blacks and vice versa. And so There may be ways in which they offset each other. That's possible. I don't know. This is pure speculation since I've not done the research. I've not seen any research on that. But that is something that's worth looking at. I do agree that, that would be an interesting question to see whether or not there are ways in which there may be, you know, I guess you could look at intersectionality theory. You know, I'm not a huge supporter of it, but I mean, you could look at that and talk about the intersections being Black and Christian in certain environments could be a double jeopardy. But once again, until I do research or see research, I can't affirm that.
Fair enough. Yeah, I thought about it as I'm going through the questions. I'm like, man, you know what? I'm gonna ask Dr. Yancey if he ever seen that. Man, I'm gonna ask him that. You know, so yeah, I'm gonna throw that one at you real quick. Okay, so I understand that. You know, correct me if I'm wrong. I don't want to misrepresent your position. You would say before if you're in the beginning stage of your college career, you know, your first couple years, it's okay to put your Christian belief out there, right? If you're a freshman or a sophomore in college,
it probably won't matter if you're a freshman or sophomore. Most professors don't care enough to really get into that with you. If you're a freshman, you're a freshman in a class of 50 students, and you know, as long as you're doing your work and respecting the professor and staying on, you know, not taking things off to left field or right field, you know, I think that's, yeah, it's nothing.
But you do prescribe to, if you're trying to, you're getting your doctorate, or if you're trying, you're already in your profession as a doctor and you're trying to get your research approved or trying to get funding for your research, how do you go about that as far as putting your Christian faith out there, putting your belief system out there?
Okay. One thing I've said, and I say this based on the research, and I don't like saying this, but I think you have to be honest with people, that if you're a Christian applying for a job in academia, you know, you've got your doctorate, you're applying for a job, that is not to your advantage to let people know that you're a Christian. You know, that's just the way, especially if you're in the humanities or social sciences, especially if you're in something like English. You know, it is not to your advantage. You're less likely to get the job. It doesn't mean you won't. It doesn't mean that there's some sort of hard and fast barrier, but you are going to be less likely to get the job unless you're applying for a, you know, a Christian school or something like that. So what that means and how you have to adjust your vita or your cover letter, just consider that. You know, once you're there, what does it mean? You know, I mean, I don't want to prescribe, even if it helps you to hide your faith the rest of your career, because that's not a way to live. Mm-hmm. But you have to decide. One thing that I will say that within the confines of your own discipline, you need to couch things according to the rules and norms of that discipline. And not necessarily your theological beliefs. And what I mean by this is I used to study multiracial churches, okay? One of the reasons why I say multiracial churches is, you know, I'm concerned about the body of Christ. I want the body of Christ to be able to become more racially inclusive. You know, Sunday morning, most segregated time of the week. You know, I like to see that change. As a Christian, I'm motivated to do that. When I write for academic journals, for academic books, that is not what goes in there. What goes in there is, you know, we're studying a sociological theory known as contact hypothesis, and we're looking whether or not contact in a religious setting is going to create a more advantageous racial attitude and how people adjust to that. You know, I'm put in the context of being a sociologist and what sociological theories I'm looking at. And I think that you have to learn how to do that depending on what your field is. Some fields that wouldn't matter at all. Math wouldn't matter at all, obviously. Mm-hmm. Be on your field, you have to learn how to talk in the language of that field, just like anyone else has to.
Yeah.
If your work is perceived as being advantageous to Christians, especially conservative Christians, chances are it's going to be more harshly attacked. It's going to be criticized more strongly. That's just the way it is. That's reality. So the more you can couch it in the nomenclature of that field and the acceptable boundary of that field, the better off you're going to be, and the more easier it's going to be for you to get your work into the journals you want to get it into.
But what if somebody, you know, it's always that accusation out there. Well, you're not relying on Christ. You know, you're relying on your own efforts. You know, you're not relying fully on the grace of God. You know, gotta get it done. Just tell them about Christ. You know, what do you say about situations like that where other Christians may come at you and say, "Well, Dr. Yancey, you're not showing enough faith." Then,
I don't think anyone's ever said that, but if they were. If they were, I would point at Paul. What did Paul do? Paul used the fact that he was a Roman citizen to get out of, you know, being punished more harshly whenever he was before. Now I forget the name of the. But anyways, you know, Paul was wise. Paul, you know, didn't just say, well, you know, God's gonna give me out of this punishment. Paul said, no, I'm a Roman citizen. Hey, this is wrong. You guys sent me to Rome.
Yeah,
and so I don't see anything wrong with that. Being wise about what's out there and the ways of the world, and once you get into those sort of positions, I wasn't as open about being a Christian in the first few years I was in academia, but now, you know, you Google me, you know, I don't care anymore. I have tenure. I can do what I want to do.
Yeah,
and so I can speak out on issues, and so having people to speak out on those issues, I think, is a value as well. If you can never get to the place where you can get published to speak on those issues, then I think something is lost. So, you know, God can do anything, and I've accepted that, and I know that, and I'm not disputing that. I'm just saying that, you know, there's also wisdom in being a little cautious, at least early on in one's career.
Okay. I hear that. What are there any instances where this Christianophobia is misinterpreted? You know, it's have you encountered that as far as in your research that, well, this is not really a clear case of Christianophobia? You know, this is just misrepresentation or misinterpretation of what may look like it.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's an interesting question. I think to some degree, any type of bigotry look, we know there's fake hate crimes. So if people are willing to fake a hate crime, then people are willing to fake other things. And so
one name comes to mind, Mr. Jesse Smollett.
Yes. But I mean, there's websites with all these fake hate crimes. So, you know, so they happen. I mean, I'm not saying they happen often. I'm not saying, I don't know, but you know, there's no denying that they happen. And so if fake hate crimes can happen, why couldn't a Christian fake, you know, Christianophobia? I would not deny that takes place. How often that happens, I don't know. There are Christians who blow things out of proportion. You know, I'm sure there's been professors, and including myself, who've had people who think, oh, the professor's out to get me because I'm a Christian, when they just did terrible work.
Yeah.
So you know, there, and so that is there. I personally don't use the word persecution.
Okay.
When I talk about Christianophobia here in the United States, because I think of persecution as what's happening to the Muslims in China, happening to some of the Christians in China, you know, what's happening to Christians in some of the Middle Eastern countries. You know, that's persecution. Doesn't mean that there isn't anti-Christian discrimination, and doesn't mean that there isn't anti-Christian discrimination that is wrong. But I get a little uneasy when people talk about, oh, you know, I've documented persecution because I've never claimed to document persecution, not here in the United States. And so I think words mean something. And so we should use, you know, the right term for what is happening in the United States, which is discrimination, which is bias, which is bigotry, but not persecution. We're not being directly tossed in jail for our faith or being killed for our faith, or, and thank God we aren't. But I'm just saying that, you know, I think we need to distinguish between people who are really suffering for their faith and some of the problems that we are going to be encountering here.
Yeah. It's growing, man. It's growing. We ain't seen the full magnitude of it yet, but I do believe that it's growing to that level. It's getting there. But we'll see what happens, you know. We'll see what happens with that. But I do have what would you say to somebody who is experiencing this? You know what I mean? What would be the first steps that they should take in order to deal with this possible issue of having a bias for somebody else because that other person's Christian? You know what I mean? So what would you say to somebody who's currently going through that
And someone who's suffering from it, you mean? Someone who's experiencing Christianophobia?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, you know, I would document as much as I possibly could. And honestly, if it's in a situation where legal help is what you need, then I would look at getting legal help. You know, obviously you can't always document what's happening, and sometimes it's not something that any sort of legal that has legal recourse. But I honestly think that's hard to convince someone who's engaging in Christianity that they're not, because once again, they think that they're being tolerant. Yeah. And so, you know, I would not say, okay, I'm going to talk to this person. I'm talking them out of doing that. You know, I would look at my institutional options, my legal options, and look at it that way. I would also make sure that it's really Christianophobia. And so I would ask hard questions about, you know, is this really good work that they're criticizing, or, you know, or is this work that maybe it's not the best, and the critiques may be justified. Mm-hmm. So, or, you know, are they mistreating you because you're a Christian, or are they mistreating you because you've not treated them well too? So, mm-hmm. you know, yeah. So, you know, I think you should ask some tough questions like that. But if you come to the conclusion that it is anti-Christian bias, I would get legal. I mean, and there are institutions out there that if you really have a case, they'll take them for pro bono. Mm-hmm. So I definitely will look at those options.
Interesting. So, you know, we talked about the whole Christianophobia in academia. We talked about, you know, the biases that may lay there. We talked about your studies and everything. So, you know, but the most important question is my final question for you. Mm-hmm. So if you can take time real quick for me and just tell the world, what is the gospel truth?
And this issue, or the gospel as far as salvation? Yeah. Let me talk what I've talked about to the gospel in this sense. I've already alluded to one of the big differences between Christians and the world is our notion of humans. You know, are humans fallible? Are humans perfectible or not? Our faith says humans are not perfectible, not in this earth, that our perfectibility comes afterwards, because we need Christ in order to reach that. The lack of recognizing that we need Christ is a big part of what leads to so much of the problems we have, including Christianophobia. Because when we don't recognize our need for Christ, then we feel that we are perfectible, and it gives us freedom to do things that, you know, anywhere from irritating to horrible. Mm-hmm. And so Christophobia to me is not anything special. You know, who has it, you know, is different, and there's unique aspects. There's nothing special. It's just another way in which humans sin against other humans, because we do not reach perfectibility in this side of heaven. We can strive for it, we should strive for it, but we're not going to totally reach it this side of heaven. And so, you know, in this sense, you can look at Christophobia as, you know, a way of pointing back to Christ, because it's again, another reminder that education will not save you, that the right politics will not save you, having good philosophy will not save you. You still have something inside that's eaten away at you that compels you to mistreat people that you don't agree with, to set these stereotypes. And until you allow Christ to deal with that, it's not going to go away. And even when Christ comes in, you know, it's still going to be a struggle, but at least you have a shot to try to control it. And so, you know, Christianophobia reminds us that this is not limited, you know, that people who haven't made, you know, economically, educationally, racially, they still have this hole in them that compels them to act out in these ways. And so for me, you know, that's my best answer to that question.
All right. Yeah, man, it's... You know, it's that sinful desire in people's hearts, you know, to act out, as you said, to act out. Always, I like how you put it, all the way from irritating to horrible. I love that. That's a good gauge, man. So, yeah, man. So it's always that saving grace by Christ, you know, that we all need. So, Thank you, Dr. Yancey, man. Thank you for coming on. I appreciate you, sir. And so where could everybody find your content or perhaps find your the study that we're talking about today?
Okay. The study that we're talking about as far as the academic study was from a book called, now I forgot the name, oh, Compromising Scholarship. That's the academic study. The Christianophobia study, which is more generalized, the academic study is from a book called So Many Christians, So Few Lions. Okay. I also have written a Christian book that that pulls some of my research together and talks, you know, and it's written, you know, to Christians. And so while I think the other books are readable, this one is especially readable, you know, because it is a Christian book. And I'm trying to remember the name of it off the top of my head. So I'm a little bit embarrassed right now. Wait, I have it here somewhere. I know this is bad. And I have the wrong, anyways, go to my website, georgeyancey.com. and I cannot remember the name of, oh, wait a second. Here it is. Hostile Environment.
Hostile environment. Okay.
For some reason, I just drew a blank on that one. A hostile environment.
You know why you drew a blank, Doctor? Is because you wrote so many books and so many articles, man. So, hey, it happens, man. It happens to the best of us, man.
Okay.
It's all good, man. Thank you once again, Doctor. I appreciate your time. Thank you. I'm a busy man with the family and the boys and everything. So I do appreciate you, man. And may God bless you.
Okay. God bless you.
All right. All right, folks, Dr. George Yancey came on and gave us the rundown, right? The rundown on his Christianophobia, gave us the rundown of some of the research he's done. And, you know, it's always a blessing to be able to get folks on here who know what they're talking about, you know. And Dr. Yancey is one of those individuals, man. So once again, thanks for Dr. Yancey for taking time out of the busy schedule to come on The Gospel Truth. But with that said, I do want to rehash some of the stuff that's coming up. November 23rd, once again, 5 p.m., Will Duffy versus C.J. Barnes. And everybody is Open Theism Biblical. November 27th at 6 p.m., Daniel Cahey versus Anthony Silvestro. And everybody, Young Earth Creation and Morality in the Bible. November 29th at 6 p.m., David Powman versus David Lewis. Is Calvinism True? And November 30th at 5 p.m., Zach Turvis versus Craig Joyner, and they're debating, does Calvinism teach the biblical understanding of the gospel? Be on the lookout for those. And just go ahead, go to the YouTube page, the Facebook page, and the podcast, and subscribe there. Like and follow. Share the content. It's always a great thing when we're able to engage the culture of Christian truth. And once again, the gospel truth is about doing that. Engaging the culture of Christian truth through interviews, debates, and biblical lessons. So be on the lookout for everything that's coming up. Share it, get it out there, tell your family and friends about it, and, you know, keep this ministry in prayer. You know, we need the prayer. We need the prayer big time in order to continue to do what God has called us to do. Also, you know, just putting out there, you know, I would love to get support, you know what I mean? And sometimes ministries, they need financial support. You know, so I will hope that, you know, that you would put it on your heart, put it in your prayer list, you know, maybe God to put on your heart to help or give a one-time donation to assist the gospel truth in efforts to proclaim the gospel through interviews, debates, and biblical studies. Anyway, I'm going to go ahead and get out of here. May God keep you and may God bless you. Be on the lookout for all the coming shows. God bless.